Jesus has given me. Thank you.
not going to believe the lie of a defeated devil. Come on, one more time. Just lift it up. You've got that lost loved one that you don't think can ever be saved. You've got that healing you need in your body, and the devil told you it won't ever be done. The relationship that can never be repaired. The marriage that can't be fixed. The child is too far gone. Come on, nothing is impossible for Jesus. Come on, where's your faith at tonight? Come on, sing it again. Nothing is impossible. Tonight, if you know He's all you really need, hallelujah. Amen. Just a moment ago, we were singing about the authority of God. You know what's amazing to me is, how many realize, first of all, Jesus gave you authority as a believer. If you believe upon the name of Jesus, if He's in your heart, I don't care what end of the spectrum you feel like you are as a Christian. Some people may feel like, you know, well, I'm just this type of Christian. I don't do all that. I don't really, you know, speak for my family. I don't really have that kind of, you know, boldness about me. I don't care how long you've been saved or how long you've been serving God or how deep you feel like you are with God. You need to realize, first of all, that you have authority in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody. Second of all, authority is no good if you don't have faith that it works. If you don't believe that it works, then authority does you no good. You can sit and rebuke and bind and shout and scream and all those things all you want to, but if in your heart you don't believe that God really is able to do all things exceedingly, abundantly, above all, if you don't really believe that God is able to rebuke it when you rebuke it, or to touch the situation when you pray over it, or to heal the sickness, or to fix something that is incurable, all those things that you feel like are so impossible, that's what faith does. Faith engages in authority. And the Bible says that we speak things that are not as though they already were. And that's what faith does, and that's what authority does. So I say all that to say, you don't have to deal, and I call him defeated because he's already defeated. Can we get that straight? We're not waiting on Jesus to get victory. He's already won the victory. We're not waiting on him to make things get better. He's already won. So if Jesus already has the victory, that's why I call him a defeated devil. And what we do is we are so bad sometimes about acting like that we are having to seek or search for this like great big strategy and just hoping things will work out or hoping that there can be a miracle or hoping that God can do something. The reality is, though, with your faith engaged in God, you have the authority to speak to the enemy that is lurking in your marriage or in your children or in your home or in your finances or in whatever situation that you're dealing with. And as soon as the enemy is messing around in those things, God gives you authority through the name of Jesus. That's why we say, in the name of Jesus. Or we rebuke the devil and we say, in the name of Jesus. Why do people do that? Because there is power in that name. We just said Sunday that God gave Jesus the name that is above every other name. Above every other name. Everything bows at the name of Jesus. Sickness, disease, human beings, presidents, kings, queens. all of them one day, when the end has come and Jesus Christ has established his kingdom over in the city of God, every single knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Amen. They're going to line up by the droves, kings and priests and rulers and princes down Ben Yehuda Street, and they will bow down and kneel their knee down to the carpenter's son. Hallelujah. It is going to be a reality. At the name of Jesus, there is still enough power to break every chain. There is still enough power to run him off. You don't have to let him camp out at your home or in your marriage or situations that are going on in your life. That's why I'm so urgent to put it in your spirit to use that authority in the name of Jesus, because nothing is impossible. Get your faith engaged and just know when you begin to claim that in faith, God backs that up. It's not in your name, because if it's in your name, it does no good. I can't rebuke anything in my name. If it comes out of my mouth and it doesn't have any power to back it up, it does me no good. But when I look at a situation and I say, in the name of Jesus, heaven begins to listen and God's ear is turned to those who have faith. It's just like the woman with the issue of blood. He said, hey, somebody has got faith enough and power is coming out of me. It's almost like you reach up and just touch the hem of his garment and power begins to intentionally come out and go into a situation. You have authority. God wants you to use it. Somebody give him praise if you're thankful for it tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, slap two or three people and say, you got authority as you're seated. You've got authority and you better learn how to use it. Amen.
We're going to continue our worship with our tithes and offering. Tithing teaches us to put God first, which is right where he should be. It should be God, family, work. A lot of people have that mixed up, and that's okay. But, you know, tithing also lets us be faithful, and God is so faithful to us. We all have a story of that. The check in the mailbox that you didn't expect, the dinner from your neighbor when you weren't sure how you were going to eat, those are all from God. It wasn't just because you're super special and, you know, people just give you things. It came from God, and that is why we need to be faithful in our tithing. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to you and we ask that you bless the gift and the giver. That the tithes that we take, we will put them back into your kingdom. And Lord, we just give you all the glory for the faithfulness that you show us every day in our personal lives. And here, as we look around, compassion, all your blessings are so abundantly clear. And Lord, we just give you the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Starting at 1. We are going to have food, candy, inflatables, games, and of course tons of eggs. The bin is already out in the lobby, and we need your help with lots of candy. If you don't have time to go shopping, that's okay. We'll do the shopping for you. This event gets bigger and better every year.
Hey, Compassion family. Join us this year on March 24th for Palm Sunday. This is normally a kids event, but we're extending it to the whole church. So be sure to wear your best Hawaiian shirt with your whole family and join us for a fun day.
Hey, Compassion family. We are so excited for Easter at Compassion.
That's right. It's Easter 2024. It's almost here. We're going to have two services again at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And we can't wait to see your family as we continue our sermon series, Risen. We're also going to have communion together. It's going to be an amazing time celebrating the risen Jesus.
We hope to see you here.
If you have any questions or just need more information, see any of our friendly volunteers at our Welcome Center. And that's what's happening.
Amen. How many are excited about Easter Extravaganza coming up Saturday? Anybody excited but me? Can't be just me. Amen. It's going to be so much fun. You want to be here at Compassion Church Saturday afternoon at 1 o'clock. Make sure you're here. Bring everybody that you can. Everybody's invited. This is not just open to our church. This is open to the public as part of one of our outreaches that we do throughout the year. So it is for our kids, but for everybody too. Anyone else that you want to invite and bring, it's free. And so we're going to have popcorn and cotton candy and snow cones. We have thousands of Easter eggs filled with candy that all the kiddos are going to get to hide according to their age group. And some of them are going to have golden eggs and they can win prizes. So you don't want to miss that. Make sure your kids are here. We'll have inflatables and all sorts of things. So it's going to be such a fun day. My wife, Pastor Noel, remind me Saturday what time the volunteers need to be here again. That's what I thought, 11:30. So if you're helping to volunteer and you want to be here to help us with that, 11:30 on Saturday. And we could certainly use any and all help that we can get. And if you know what? We have fun serving around here. It's not work. We have a good time doing it. If you're looking to make friends and connect and know people in the church, I promise you, number one way is serving somewhere. I'm not just saying that. I promise. Ask anybody who is serving at this church. You will make more friends real quick than you've ever thought doing anything else. That and find you a small group. Amen. Palm Sunday is also this coming Sunday. They were just announcing there. Don't forget your Hawaiian shirt this coming Sunday. We'll have a photo booth and just have a lot of fun celebrating Hosanna and talking about the triumphant entry into Jerusalem of Jesus Christ. And it's going to be such a good day in our series, Risen, in the part four of our series. So make sure you do that. And also, don't forget, be inviting people now. Come on, people are busy. Invite people to Easter Sunday. I hope that your homework is for everybody to invite at least one person, hopefully 20, but at least one. Come on. We have two service options, so we'll have plenty of room, 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. on Easter Sunday. It's going to be very special with communion, and I believe our kids are singing. Our kids' choir will be singing, and both services, by the way, will be the same, just like last year, copy of both, relatively the same, so you can choose whichever one, or if you want to stay both, I don't care. You can stay and have a double dose. At this time, we'll let everybody who's going to be dismissed take off tonight, and we're getting ready to jump into a little bit of a word. So good to see you. Thank you for being here for midweek. Great crowd tonight. If you're on our online campus, we're so thankful that you are watching with us. Such a blessing to always have everybody on there. Comment, let us know where you're watching from. We're thankful that you are having church with us. If you have your Bible, in just a moment, I'm going to be in the book of Hebrews, and we're going to be over in chapter 12. If you don't have it, we'll get it on the screen for you. Everybody's had a good week so far, enjoying this weather. It's been mild and just absolutely beautiful, a little bit windy at times, but I'm enjoying it. I want to just say, as a foundation here before I even start into the scripture, I believe tonight's message is for every single one of us. I believe it's for every single person. This is something that every single person is guilty of at times, one way or the other. And I think it's going to help you because we are human beings. You can take a deep breath and relax. God does not expect you to be perfect. I'm not sure why you do. I'm not sure why you expect to be perfect. There's too much pressure on yourself. It's natural human feeling what we're going to be talking about here this evening. But help me announce the title here to what we're going to be talking about to your closest neighbor. And you might have to shout a little bit if they're spread out. Holler at them and say, neighbor. Come on, y'all. Wake up, say, neighbor. Get out of your head. You know what happens when we get inside of our own head, as we say, if you get in your head or get inside your own thoughts, you know what happens whenever you do that? Sometimes if you meditate on something too long, you can have a whole lot of discouragement. You can discourage yourself if you're in your head for too long, if you overthink things. Can I be real? I'm real with y'all. I hope y'all don't run and tell all my secrets. I overthink things all the time, like even the smallest things. I overthink everything. I can be at a restaurant and panic order. Y'all ever done that before? Because I've looked over the menu 35 times. Some of y'all that go out to eat with me, you know what I'm talking about, that you've been with me to dinner before. I look over it 35 times, and then they come to me, and I'm like, just give me this floundered eel. You know, and I'm like, what did I just order? And then I get it, and I'm mad because I've got something I don't like. Y'all ever done that before? Okay, it's just me. Y'all pray for me. I panic, and I overthink things sometimes. And right now, I sold my vehicle last week, so now I'm in the market for a vehicle. So you can just imagine how that's going, swimmingly, trying to find a vehicle. That decision, I'm like, this is too much. I'm about to just go get a Miata and be done with it. Just a little two-seater, $1,000 Miata and just be done. The reality is, if you get in your head too long, the devil will use that to make you overthink everything. Because discouragement, you know, the devil loves discouragement because listen to this. This is very profound, but it's very true. Did you know, and maybe you didn't realize this, the devil uses your mind for probably, safe to say, every single one of his tricks every single one of his temptations, every single one of his attacks. I would dare say that nearly every single one of them are in your mind. Think about that. Now I ask you, how powerful is it to have strength in your mind after hearing that? How important is it that you're very mentally strengthened, that you have the Spirit of God navigating your thoughts, and that you are not in your head for too long, as we say? How do you even get strength in your mind? Maybe your question. What happens if you stay discouraged too long in your head? Let's break some of this down in Hebrews chapter 12. Therefore, the Bible said in verse 1, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight. Somebody say every weight. And the sin which so easily ensnares us. That's just the nature of sin. If you're not careful, it will easily ensnare you. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. Oh, he is still the author and the finisher of our faith. Hallelujah. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Father, help us tonight to understand the word. Let us be encouraged, lifted up, challenged as always, and just help us to draw closer to you. I pray that none of us would leave exactly the way that we came in. Let us in some way be different. Let us in some way, all of us, be closer to your heart and have a better understanding of you, your plans, and our relationship with you. God, help us to realize that if we stay too long inside of our heads, that we will sometimes hear our own voice, our own thoughts, and we will miss the voice of God. I praise you that you are still moving. I thank you that you are helping us to take every thought that is negative or cruel or unkind or those things that are punishable in our minds. You are taking those thoughts captive, and I believe that you are not only rebuking assignments of the enemy, but I believe that you are rebuking assignments of our own flesh. Sometimes the enemy needs to be rebuked, but God, sometimes if we're honest, our own flesh needs to be rebuked. And I'm thankful that you do both. Help us to understand your word tonight, God, and give us encouragement as we might be facing discouragement. We love you and ask all of this in Jesus' name. And somebody said, amen. The Hayden Planetarium in New York City ran an advertisement a number of years ago in New York newspapers, and they were inviting those who would like to make the trip and journey of a lifetime to submit their applications so that they could journey to another planet. Within a matter of days, they reported that they had over 18,000 people who applied to go to another planet. These applications were then given to a panel of psychologists because they wanted to study exactly what this could mean. And these psychologists received them, and they had all concluded that the vast majority of these applicants who had applied, they wanted to start a new life on another planet because they said they were so discouraged with their lives on this one. Isn't it a sad thing that we feel like that the only way of escape from all of our discouragement and what we're dealing with is just to get out of this whole planet and start over somewhere else? Some people feel like they can pick up their life and move to the other side of the county, the other side of the state, maybe another state or another country around the world, and people feel like they can just always escape their problems by doing so. But I want to tell you, discouragement is something that all of us, if we're really all honest from time to time, all of us deal with it sometimes. Everyone deals with discouragement at times because sometimes life just happens. Sometimes things just don't work out like we thought they would, and we get discouraged when it doesn't. Plans get out of control. Prayer requests go unanswered, or sometimes God just says no. And then we get discouraged, and we don't quite see what is going to happen next. It's easy for us, family, to allow the pressures and all of those burdens in our lives to overwhelm us. I mean, cause you despair, cause you to lose sleep, and to be so discouraged. And if we're just really honest, putting a name to it, discouragement is a killer. Discouragement is the quickest way to take the wind out of your sails. It's the quickest way to rain on your parade. It's the quickest way to, cause your fire to go out. If you're not careful, discouragement has caused so many people to drop out of churches. Discouragement has caused a multitude of people to quit on God. Discouragement has even caused pastors and preachers of the Word of God to give up the fight and lay down their Bibles because they were so discouraged. Charles Spurgeon had this to say about his own battles with discouragement. He said, "Discouragement creeps over my heart and makes me go, with heaviness to my work. It is dreadfully weakening. My goodness, I mean, how just blunt is that? And really, maybe that is the way that with, you know, many of us tonight, maybe that's just the way that we came in here feeling, just discouraged. Like, just the very room that we're in, we just feel an atmosphere hanging over us of discouragement. Maybe you're here and you thought about just throwing the towel in and dropping out on God. This is too hard. This is not what I signed up for. This is not what I had in mind when I said yes to you. But can I just encourage you, before you do, I would like to just remind you that God did not save you so that you could live your life in a state of discouragement and confusion. I am so thankful that as we have just entered into the spring season, that seasons change. Winter changes to spring. Spring will at some point change to summer. Summer will change into the fall. And I'm so grateful to know that as seasons begin to change in the natural, also in the supernatural realm of God, seasons will also change. Ecclesiastes, in fact, says that seasons will change. There's a time for this and a time for that, it says. 2 Timothy 1 and 7 says it like this: "For God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind, of peace in your head." God did not intend for you to always live in a state of discouragement. There are going to be moments and times that the devil sees an opportunity and he will put you in a place of discouragement. Separation from everyone else, because that is one of his favorite tactics. Separation and isolation will cause you to feel like you're all alone. Like you're the only one dealing with your problems and nobody else deals with it. You're the only one. You can be sitting in a room full of people at church and the devil will say, "You're the only one dealing with this addiction. You're the only one who struggles with looking at that mess on your phone. You're the only one that struggles with taking that drink every night before bed so you can have peace and feel like that you can relax. You are the only one." Discouragement can be a killer. It can be the quickest way to feel like that God has given up on you, but it could not be further from the truth. See, this verse that we just read in 2 Timothy 1 and 7 would seem to indicate that you and I do not have to live with discouragement after all. How many can just say thank God and wave your hand and give him some praise on that? You don't have to live with discouragement, and it does not have to be your constant companion. Discouragement does not have to be your roommate that just hangs out with you. And I think the Bible teaches us that it is possible to win the battle over discouragement. It can be there for a moment, for a season sometimes, but I believe that once again, if you're talking about authority, that you have the authority to make sure that it does not stay. Can somebody say amen? Get out of your head. Don't let that mess live there. See, God has a plan to deliver you from the gloomy effects of discouragement because he never intended for you to just stay in that place. Once again, I want to make it clear. I'm not saying that you are not allowed to be discouraged. Sometimes all of us get in that place. And I'm just saying this, God is able to still even deliver you from discouragement. You don't have to live there. In fact, I think these verses that we read this evening talk so much about accomplishing just that in your life. See, these verses give us a plan, and if they are followed, I think that this can really help prevent the infection that discouragement can really bring as you run your race, as Hebrews just told us, with the Lord. I think every believer must commit to a life of faithful running, as he would call it. This requires preparation. If you were here last Wednesday, we talked a little bit about preparation and even, in fact, talked a little bit about running in a race. I think preparation goes hand in hand with this because, once again, nobody just wakes up in the morning and decides that they're going to run a marathon of several miles without any training at all and just think that that could happen. Because I run 5Ks occasionally, but I'm just telling you all, if I was trying to run, what's a half marathon, some 13-something miles or so, I think that I would fall out dead flat on my face before I ever got close to that finish line right now. It takes preparation. It takes a time that we have to get ready for that. But can I just tell you, though, that kind of race, although it requires preparation, so does the spiritual race. You need to get yourself ready for this thing that you're, this is not a sprint. We are not, I see so many people, I love the zeal and the passion of a newborn Christian, as we call them. Somebody will get saved, give their heart to Jesus. Man, they want to come and get baptized, and that is your next step, and praise God. They're looking to, like, you know, find their place to belong and serve, and I love every bit of that. Their zeal is just precious because they're so on fire for God, and they want to run and tell everybody about their experience, and you should. All of that, none of that's wrong so far, and all of those things are wonderful, but if you're not careful, you will feel like that this thing is a sprint, and you quickly are just having to rush and get there and just do this and do that. And really the essence of living for God is this marathon to where you have to pace yourself and realize what you can handle and what you cannot. You cannot put so much on yourself that you experience burnout and discouragement and you're just done with all of it. I even tell people who serve at this church, I'm like, you can serve on a team, you can serve on more than one team, but the moment you feel like you're done, you're discouraged, and you're dreading even coming to this church to serve, we got to talk. Because if you get burnt out and discouraged, not only are you not going to want to serve, but you're not even going to want to come to church. Major problem, because your relationship with God, it comes before anything else. That's number one. Amen? And if we're to run well, this race, as Hebrews called it, then we have to prepare properly. How do you prepare properly? You have to be in prayer, and you also have to be in the Word of God. You're going to get strength in those two places. Anything, by the way, that would hinder us from running this race well, as Hebrews would say here, I believe it has to be laid aside. That's a longer way of saying you need freedom in your life. How many are grateful to be free in Jesus? Freedom looks good on you. Freedom feels even better when you have experienced the freedom of God within you and you are no longer held by shackles and chains and things that used to hold you down. You don't have to struggle with anxiety and depression and suicidal thoughts and taking pills or a drink every time you feel like a difficult situation is coming on. Don't reach for a brown paper bag because you're about to hyperventilate. Get yourself in prayer and seek God's word for your life. I promise you something in here has already been written to make a promise over you that everything is really going to be all right. This will lift you up more than any high than you can ever experience in your life. Because I've tried them and I'm telling you, this is where I want to be in God's word, experiencing the power of the Lord Jesus Christ in my life. So if this is a spiritual race, if we're going to run well, we need to prepare. And anything, once again, that hinders you, you need to get rid of it and have freedom in Jesus. Not just typical sins. I'm not talking about just, you know, what we talk about, what we label as the big sins, you know, and we talk about drugs, alcohol, pornography, and maybe we might every now and then throw gossip and, you know, cuss, filthy mouth and all the stuff in there. But can I tell you, you also need to talk about being free from some shame and some guilt and some depression and sadness and anxiety and all types of things that can be doom and gloom in your life and hold you down and feel like you are hitting a ceiling and you just cannot get any higher and you're just hitting this roadblock above your head and like this is just all there is, and you need to break through that thing and realize there is so much more for you in Christ Jesus. God will break the lid off of what you feel like you are enclosed in. Runners will quite literally strip away all the things that are not necessary so they can run faster and farther. They get lean, and then they also want to be light so that they can run their race really well. Man, what a lesson that is for Christians trying to run our race. How does that line up with us trying to live for God? Can I tell you, anything that has more of you, don't miss this, and if you're taking notes, write this down. Anything that has more of you than Jesus has to go if you're going to run your race well. Period. If it has more of you than God does, it's too much. It's too costly. It's not worth your peace. It's not worth your relationship with God. It's not worth you getting discouraged and being done and burnt out with everybody and everything. It's not worth it. It's too expensive. If it has more of you than Jesus does, you better find a way to cut it off and do it real quick. Whatever has your attention, your time, your resources, all of your strength and is getting everything from you, it can be a weight in your life, family. And the Bible says there is a time and a place for all of those certain things that are important. But can I tell you, sometimes it has to be laid completely aside if you're going to run your race well. There are some things that I have sacrificed because I knew that I needed Him greater than those things I sacrificed. Some things are more important to me than Jesus. That's the reason why a lot of people, and even I'm talking about Christians here, I'm not talking about people that don't know Jesus who are lost, because they don't care about that. Now, intermittent fasting is a popular thing with diets, but I'm talking about an actual fast to seek God. There's a reason why Christians don't even want to fast and can't find time or even the desire or urge to ever push aside the plate and just fast and seek and pray God. First of all, we struggle with trying to deny ourselves in many ways. That's not just with food, that's in all sorts of things. And our flesh says, man, if it feels good, bring it on, baby, let's do it. And it's not easy telling this flesh no, because we're living in it. Can we be real? We're living in it. And when the flesh wants it, it's a fight with the spirit to get victory over the flesh. All of us are in this kind of fight today. Paul said it best. You are in a constant fight with your spirit and flesh. They're butting heads, and one of them is going to win. The one who is the strongest, being fed, being beefed up by either the word of God or the things out in the world, one of them is going to win, and that choice is up to us. It's up to you. It's up to me for my life. And if we're not careful, All of these things will come against us, and if we don't deny ourselves and get closer to God, we will remain in our head. We will get so discouraged. Our time, our attention, our resources, all those things will weigh us down so much. And the Bible says, again, there is a place for that, but if you're not running your race well, there are things that you're going to have to reevaluate in your life. If it isn't dealt with, you'll become discouraged. Last month, I preached a sermon to you. Go back and watch it if you didn't see it, but I called it Handle It or Be Handled. If you don't get a handle on it, it will handle you. If you're not careful, and if you don't get victory over that thing, it will have victory over you. Can anybody say amen? So everyone who proclaims the name of Jesus needs freedom from that sin that entangles you. And the picture here, oh God, is that the time? 8:05. Y'all pray for me because I'm struggling. Y'all got time? Okay, if you got to go, just wave at me on the way out because I gotta get through this and we got a long way to go. Here we go. This picture here, though, is really of, like, even this athlete. Talking about somebody getting light and ready and, like, running the race. This athlete here who is really trying to strip himself down to be lighter here so he can run well. In fact, did you know in the ancient Greek games, a lot of times they have said in history that a lot of them would run them nude. Amen. Come on, aren't y'all? Thank goodness we've improved that over the years with uniforms and stuff. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm thankful that we ain't having to deal with that. But can you just imagine a world-class athlete running a race, a marathon, in a three-piece suit and tie, dress shoes? Can you imagine? I mean, that sounds insane to us, but that's the thought that the Bible is giving us to shed everything that could entangle you and mess you up. He says, put it aside. As a Christian runner, you are trying to run this race with grace. You are trying to take it a day at a time. We freak out and we're trying to make our plans for weeks and months. And I'm not saying don't make your plans because all of us need a plan. You've got to have a direction on where you're going. But we put so much emphasis on all of that. But God said, really, you need to take it a day at a time. You have the power in the present. You don't have your own power for the future. Trust God for that. God has the power for the future. You speak it in faith. You trust God that he's got your future in your hands. And you run this race with some steady endurance. And I believe that even though you'll make some mistakes after you get saved, at some point, family, in our imperfections, we're still going to do what the Bible calls sin and mess up, but we strive not to do those things, and plenty of times we have. But thank God when we do, there is still amazing grace, and God will help you keep getting back up and keep going with your eyes on him. How many are grateful that there is never a time that God just gives up on you and said, that's the last time I'm going to fix you? That's the last time I'm putting you back together. That's not the God we serve. I'm thankful that I pray when I thank him all the time for things in my life, I say thank you so much for being patient with me. I really do. I was here praying that very thing yesterday, walking these altars and praying for all of you and asking God to strengthen you and to help you with your battles and all that you're going through. And the first thing I always start out with is praising God for all that he's blessed me with and what he's done. And I say to him, God, thank you for not giving up on me. Thank you so much for being patient with me when I jump the gun or do something crazy that is out of your will or something that I just did in a hurry. Thank you for your patience. Man, talking about patience, the Bible said we run the race with patience that is set before us. And we're said to be in a race. This word literally comes from the term that means struggle or a contest. This is where we get our English word agony from. How encouraging is that? Running this thing in a struggle with agony. My goodness, what a word. We'll stop right there and go home and have a good night. That sure does sound like a rough road ahead, doesn't it? I mean, like, come on, man, agony. Like, why couldn't we get something real good here? I mean, like, sometimes life is good, amen? When it's good, it's good. God's blessing. The raise comes in. All your appliances and your car is all working. Hallelujah. Money is doing okay. The kids are halfway acting right. And, you know, marriage is seeming okay. And while you're going through those things, it's like out of nowhere, life just comes in, bam, and just does something crazy. And you're like, what was that? And then it just seems like sometimes it can spiral out of control, one thing after the other. What do we say? When it rains, it, and I've also added that and said, in my life, it don't just rain and pour. It thunders and lightnings, and here come a tornado. Amen. It's hail coming down, you know, golf ball, softball size. That's what it does in my life. I don't know about y'all. It don't just rain and pour. Sometimes I feel like, man, it just comes an absolute torrential downpour of a storm. And sometimes life is good, but sometimes it happens that way. Can I tell you, though, when life is real, real good for a long time, just keep a good eye out. Look out when you're there, because there are times when you're running and it feels like that you are blindfolded uphill through a minefield. I mean, like, just seems like there are times when it is such a struggle as the old word described it, agony. I mean, just life and misery. I mean, that must be the only one. Y'all pray for me. But, I mean, sometimes it is a struggle. It's not easy. And those are those times that call for patience. Whew, God help us, have patience. I mean, we need patience. Of course, God never said it would be easy in truth. He just said the opposite. How do I know? Your Bible said in John 6:33, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and he gives life to the whole world. When you talk about God giving us the bread coming down from heaven, what he describes giving life to the entire world, do you think that he had it easy? I mean, Jesus literally came down so that he could be beaten, tortured, and die. Beaten and die. I mean, some people act like he came down to play patty cake and high five everybody and give him a word of encouragement and just float back up to heaven and everything was going to be good. The Bible said that he was literally the lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world. His purpose was to come and to die. There is nothing easy about that. That is agony. That is difficult. It is just the opposite of a good, happy-go-lucky life all the time. Now, the word patience also means endurance. Somebody say endurance. Yeah, endurance. That means settling in for the long haul, enduring some things. We got a long haul ahead of us. And it carries this idea of being committed to the race that we're in. Watch. In spite of the obstacles, because they're going to be there. In spite of the difficulty, in spite of everything that you feel like, all of hell trying to break loose in your life, in spite of it all, we are in this thing for the long haul. Can I just tell y'all something and try not to get tore up here? When I gave my heart to Jesus, I did not say, God, save me and take away all my bad days and moments, and I'm going to try this Jesus thing. If it don't work out and I feel like I'm just, you know, facing a horrible season or discouragement and all this mess just keeps coming against me, you know, I did not come into this thing with my mind thinking, if it don't work out, I'm just done. I'm checking out. See you later. I tried and I'm out of here. I came into this thing like we do in a marriage. For better or for worse, if I'm rich or if I'm poor, in sickness and in health, God, I am married in a covenant in this relationship with you. And though none go with me, still I will follow Jesus. I have my mind made up. I started this thing to know that I'm going all the way to the end. Anybody can quit. Anybody can give up. That's easy. But I'm telling you right now, he who endures to the end shall have the robe and the crown. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of God will rise up within you and help you jump every obstacle the devil has put in your path. And guess what? Even if you fall flat on your face, God's real good at helping you get back up then too. That's grace. Though a man falls 100 times, yet can he get up 101. Grace says you can still make it. That's what commitment is. Be steady in all you do. Can I give you just a simple word right now? I'm going to help somebody out tonight. If you sing, if you teach, if you serve on a volunteer team, if you lead a small group, if you run your business and you're trying to do right before the Lord and run a Christian-type business, if you're trying to just do your career and influence people for the Lord, volunteering at your church, whatever you do, do it steady and do it for Jesus. Have a steady pace and do it for the glory of God. Get out of your head all of those thoughts that are trying to discourage you from what God called you to do, because you're in this thing for the long haul. Make up your mind to be committed to this thing. If you live to be 150 years old, guess what, baby doll? God still has a plan for your life. People act like when they get to a certain age or a certain season in their life, God must be done with me. Couldn't be further from the truth. Look at how many people in the Bible that had great years added to their life, seasoned saints of God, and he had great plans and purpose for their life. God wants to use you regardless of how young or how old you are. Whatever you do, whatever area or season you are in your life, you need to say, God, show me what I can do. Show me who I can influence. What can I do in this race to make sure that I'm not in my head and that I'm encouraged so that I can encourage somebody else? Set that Holy Ghost cruise control and stay focused in your walk with God. Amen. Your Bible talks about committing yourself to a life of focused running. And as we run the race, the Bible says we keep ourselves focused. But, you know, we're to concentrate on things that really prevent us from being discouraged as we race. The writer here tells us those things are this, focusing on the person of Jesus. It says, quote, looking unto Jesus. Now, this is how a Christian life begins. Ooh, I love this. It all begins with a look. It all begins with this look. Isaiah 45:22 said, look to me and be saved. Come on, what did it say? Look to me. It begins with a look. He said, all you ends of the earth, everybody, for I am God and there is no other. It begins with a look. We look to Jesus looking unto Jesus. Amen. He says here again in Isaiah, look to me. And this is amazing because this gives us insight into our race and helps us to realize as we run our race that we have to notice what he says here in verse 1. This race is set before us. There is a race before you. This seems to me that it would indicate that each one of us run our own race. I'm about to set somebody free tonight. I am running my race and you are running yours, but I can't run yours for you and you can't run mine for me. Get no help in the church tonight. Now let me help you understand this. If I spend my time looking at you and how well you're doing, if I'm not careful, I'm liable to be discouraged in my own race. If I am doing what I feel like is better than you, and I'm not in my lane, and I keep my eyes on you for too long, if I'm not careful, then I'm going to think, look how much better I'm doing than he is. Look how much greater God is using me than she is. If I'm not careful, then I might try to run in your lane or even stumble over my own pride if I begin to think that I'm doing better than you. That's why my best advice is run your race and stay out of everybody else's lane. You do you and let them do them. Everybody's at a different pace. Everyone is on a different level in God because of the relationship, different levels that we're in. And I might become defeated if I'm not careful. You need to stay in your lane. In other words, if I keep my eyes on you and how you're running or how you're doing and compare myself, and we compare our churches or our ministries and all these things, we're setting ourselves up for failure. We're going to be in trouble. The only way for any of us to run well is to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus because he is the only one that we have to run for. Get out of your head and all those thoughts that says you are striving to please everybody else. The devil is a liar. You're not going to stand before them whenever judgment comes. You are going to stand before the throne of God. It doesn't matter how they have disapproved you. It doesn't matter what label they've put on you or how they failed you. It doesn't matter who it is in your life that has been in a place trying to put condemnation or judgment upon you. They don't approve nor disprove you. God is the only one that can do that. He is the judge. You don't stand before them one day. You'll stand before God. If he approves of you, it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks of you. God said it like this. If I am for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. It doesn't matter. God is the judge of this race. He is the author and the finisher, the Bible said, of your life. He gives out the rewards. It's not anybody else. It's God that will do it. Hey, watch this. God qualifies the runners. You can't qualify me. I can't qualify you. I can cheer you on from the side. I can believe in you, and I can see your gifts and your talents. But I am not the one who qualifies you. God is the one who does that. Amen. It's not your haters. It's not your friends. It's not the devil or anyone else. God is the one who does the qualifying. Take your eyes off other racers and how everybody else is doing. Get your eyes on Jesus, and you will run a much better race. Can somebody say amen? Man, we're talking about focusing on all sorts of things, the performance of Jesus. And by the way, I'm grateful that we're focusing on him because I know me and I have a tendency to mess things up. It ain't my performance. I'm looking at the performance of Jesus. And not only should we keep our eyes on the Lord's person, but also his performance, what he's already done. He finished the race for us. And as I run the race for my life, I've got to take courage in the fact that Jesus has already passed this way. He already came and accomplished heaven's assignment. He completed his race so that I can complete mine. Amen. That means that as we run and face the pressures of life, then we get some help along the way. Hebrews 4 and 15 said it like this, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are." Jesus was tempted as we are, yet he was without sin. "Let us therefore come boldly," somebody say boldly, "to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." How many are grateful when you come boldly to the throne of grace that that's what you get? You don't get God smacking you over the head, cracking a whip, looking for ways that you messed up, hoping he can stop loving you, as we said Sunday, hoping it's just, you know. I mean, like, that's not it. You come to the throne room of God, and he said you come to the throne and you receive grace. You obtain mercy in your time of need. And he knew all of his trials in life. He had all those shares of all the problems, but he successfully navigated his course. Let's look at a few things here real quick, and I may have to finish this up next week, but let me just look at a few things here with you. Number one is he was born to an unwed mother. You have to understand the times. I don't have time to go into this, but I could do a whole sermon on this. Matthew 1 and 18 talks about this. His mother and father were only betrothed. It was a legal binding agreement, but they weren't actually married. And yet Mary comes up and says, "Surprise, got a baby." He's like, "I'm sorry, what? You're supposed to be a virgin and what now?" I mean, this is crazy. This was against him. She could have literally, his mama could have been killed At this time. Now, number two, he was born in a stable, Luke chapter 2 said. He was born to poor parents, again in Luke 2. He was hated and opposed by everybody else, Mark 14 said. He was charged with insanity in Mark chapter 3. He was even charged, this is crazy, with demon possession. Yeah, over in Mark chapter 3. Talking about the name above every name, and yet they said he was the one that was part of the demon, the demonic manifestation. They said that was him. The seventh thing, he was rejected and hated. He was opposed by the audiences who came to hear him speak. Matthew 13, Luke chapter 4. Number eight of this whole mess and situation here is he was betrayed by his own close friends. Man, I know none of us have been betrayed before, have we? Mark chapter 4 is where I am in your Bible, and also over in chapter 18. He was tried before the high court of the land and charged, watch this, with treason over in John chapter 18. And last, number 10, he was executed among common criminals by way of crucifixion on a cross in John 19 for one place. This is just 10 of the things that Jesus would face. Yes, he has been through a lot of it. And can I just tell you, all these things qualify him to be the perfect coach for you trying to run your race right now. He don't know what I'm going through. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding? God understands better than you do what you're going through. I come in and try to explain, and God's like, I know it a lot better than you even do. Can I help you understand it this way? God, thank you, Holy Spirit. God hears conversations that you don't hear. God will hear things said about you behind closed doors that you didn't know. That's why sometimes God will close the door. That's why he will open a different one. You didn't hear what God heard. You didn't see the plan that God saw that was about to be unfolded in your life. Be thankful when God does something to shut something down in your life. He is the perfect coach for whatever you've gone through so you can run your race. What else can we say except fix your eyes on Jesus? God will guide you. He will direct you through your life, even through the midst of discouragement. Instead of looking through every other thing, every other place to find help, you need to find help in Jesus Christ alone. Friend, listen to me. If this is you, whether you're here or watching online tonight, I have looked in every place. I know people who've looked at the bottom of every liquor bottle, the bottom of every pill bottle. They have done everything from one bed to the next in sexual relationships and crazy stuff that they have thought would fix all their problems. At the end of the day, you're going to find that you have a God-sized hole in your heart. All you really needed was Jesus all along. I have witnessed it hundreds of times where people said, I finally had to just come to the end of all my options so that I realized I just needed him. I'm going to go ahead and close here. I got a whole lot more to go. I'm going to pray about it. I may get to finish it next week if the Lord lets me, unless we got to go a different direction. But I'm going to start landing the plane here because I know it's 8:22. I don't know what's gotten into me tonight, but I could go another 30, 40 minutes. So I'm going to just right here. Some of y'all got to get in the bed. I'm looking at some of y'all. Okay, listen. You got to get out of your head, family. Get out of your head. Discouragement is one of the devil's favorite things to try to mess you up. If you get into your head too long, listen, people can fail you. Friends can turn on you. I have had people that I would have put my hand on this Bible and said they would never hurt me. They would never betray me. And for them to leave a knife in my back as they walked away from me. I have experienced it. People can do that. Family can even fail you. Can I just tell you, if you will flush all of that out of your mind and get your eyes fixed on Jesus Christ, he is the one that will never fail. He can't fail you. People are always acting like, man, I'm just searching for strategy in this thing. I'm trying to run my race. I'm trying to have my eyes on God, Pastor. I'm trying to do all the right things. And it feels like I'm always the one who keeps coming up short, keeps coming up empty-handed, confused, and just don't know what else to do. You're spending too much time in here. If you will spend more time in prayer and more time in God's word, God will open up your eyes to what he's really trying to do. Can I give somebody else some comfort too? And we're going to pray and I'll let you go home. When I'm in prayer, there's actually been research. I wish I could remember. It might have been a Barna study, but don't quote me on that. Research that has literally been done that when you're praying, they hooked people up to these machines and studied the brain activity and all these things. When you're praying and seeking God, it was impossible for the same trigger in your brain that could worry and cause anxiety and depression to go off at the same time. It couldn't happen. There was a block. It was one or the other. And tell me prayer doesn't work. Tell me that it doesn't that it doesn't calm your fears. I'm not telling you that it makes it perfect. Can I be just real with you today? I mean, just raw. There are things that I'm praying about right now that I don't have the answers to. Things that I need in my life or that I want to see God do. I don't know how it's going to end, and I don't know what the answer to it is. The reason I'm not up at night losing sleep, the reason I'm in my bed sleeping good is because I trust God, because I know that if he's the one who saved me, God will be the one that keeps me. He did not bring you this far to fail you now. Get discouragement out of your head. Use that authority. Tell the devil what a liar he is and trust God's plan. Amen. I'm going to close and pray. Y'all can go ahead and stand with me if you want to, and then I'll let you go home, and we're going to go ahead and pray and seek the Lord. And I want to just bless your life right now. In fact, I feel the Lord. Y'all know I don't do this, but can you just, the Bible talks about the right hand being authority. Can you just lift up your right hand right now? I want you to make a declaration tonight for you and your family as we pray and dismiss. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, as we lift up what you have called the right hand of authority over our marriages, over our families, over our jobs and careers, over our finances, over our homes, for every step that we will take in our future. God, I feel you on this right now. We declare in the name of Jesus at the right hand of God with authority that we have in Jesus Christ that we will rebuke discouragement and despair, that we will have strong marriages, our children will be called into the ministry and used mightily of God. Father, those that are lost in our family will come home and know Jesus Christ, and we will not give up on them. God, everything that we have been and every place we've been in our past will no longer control us from this moment forward in the name of Jesus. Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And God, in the name of Jesus, as we just read in 2 Timothy 1:7, you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind, peace in our mind. And I pray, God, that every ounce of discouragement will leave this room now in the name of Jesus. It won't go home with us. It won't travel home with us. It won't be waiting on us when we walk in the living room, when we get home. In the name of Jesus, with authority right now, we declare that discouragement will flee, the power of God will rise up within us, and we will be stronger today when we leave this place than we walked into this room. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, we reach up and speak things that are not as though they already were. We bless your name, we thank you for your word, and we declare it right now by faith in Jesus' name. Somebody seal that with a great big praise right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Love on each other on your way out. Meet me here Saturday at 1 o'clock with your kids or your grandkids, and let's have a good time. Come and serve with us at 11:30 if you can. Family, I love you. God bless you. Have an amazing rest of your week, and I'll see you either Saturday or Sunday at 10:30. Have a good week.